I'm Dan Rundy. I co-direct the U.S. Leadership and Development Project here at CSIS that was funded by Chevron, and we have many friends and family here from Chevron here today, so I want to welcome Mamadou Bay and Tam Nguyen and many other colleagues from Chevron who are here. We're doing this in conjunction with the Initiative for Global Development, and Rob Mosbacher, who is the chair of the Initiative for Global Development, is here. Thank you, Rob. And I want to, we're going to have some opening comments from my friend and colleague, Jennifer Potter, who's the CEO of the Initiative for Global Development, to help frame up the discussion that we're going to have about the business case for development, how companies drive development, how government and donors can help. So without further ado, I'm going to have my friend and colleague, Jennifer Potter, come up here and make some remarks. Jennifer.
There we go. It's great to see such a big crowd. I understand it was a turnaway situation, so that's it either suggests that our paper is very, very good, which I think it is, or that there's just tremendous interest in the subject, which may also be the case. On behalf of IGD, let me welcome everyone to CSIS for today's Chevron Forum, and I want to start by expressing our thanks and our gratitude to CSIS for hosting this, and to Chevron for sponsoring the forum and supporting IGD's efforts to promote business-driven development. Before I turn it back over to Dan to introduce a really outstanding panel, I'd like to say just a few words about why we're here today. And for those of you who don't know us, IGD engages business leaders to reduce poverty through catalytic strategic investment in the developing world, currently focused on Africa. Our network is comprised of CEOs and other senior business executives from multinational companies, US, European, African, and South Asian. These are all recognized sectoral leaders and also share our strong commitment to poverty reduction. Part of our work is to align business and government priorities in areas where overlapping interests can lead to large-scale and sustainable development impact. We recently launched Business for Better Development, an IGD project co-chaired by Chevron and IBM to help support that mission. And as a foundation for that effort, we're today releasing our working paper, The Business Case for Development, How Companies Can Drive Sustainable Development, and How Governments and Donors Can Leverage Their Impact. This working paper was written with input from a number of leading U.S., European, and African multinational companies who have had experience delivering development through their business operations in foreign markets, real on the ground, real experience. We hope that this paper, along with the conversation today with the panel, will lay the groundwork for two important conversations. One is, how do we deepen and strengthen our understanding of what companies are doing in their core business strategies to have strong development outcomes? We know a little bit about it. We gave some examples in the papers, but I think it's a much broader field and one that we need to spend more time and more discovery on. And the second one is how we would need to go forward and explore how companies can more effectively work and be engaged as the U.S. government and other donors advance new development initiatives. There is a huge upside opportunity for development agencies to leverage the power of business in this particular budget climate, and I think the recognition is growing that without the involvement of business in development, we're not really going to move the needle on poverty reduction. So with that, I'm going to turn back over to my friend and colleague Dan Rundy to introduce the panel and moderate the conversation, and thank you all so much for coming.
We really have a great panel to help lead this conversation. I want to just also underline the great efforts of Jerry Jensen, who is the Vice President here for the Initiative for Global Development here in Washington. So congratulations, Jerry, on the great work that you've done in producing this paper and helping us bring this great group together. So without further ado, I'm going to first turn to Tara Acharya, who is with Pepsi, to talk a little bit about how Pepsi sees the business case for development. Tara.
Thank you, Daniel, and thank you for inviting me to participate on this panel. It's as much a learning opportunity for me as it is to share with you what we do at PepsiCo. So perhaps before I talk a little bit about PepsiCo's vision for development, perhaps I could share a little bit about what PepsiCo is for those who may not be entirely familiar with the company. So obviously we produce Pepsi Cola, but we also produce Frito-Lay, Quaker, Tropicana, and Gatorade. Those are our major brands. So we're a food and beverage company. And if you look at our portfolio in other parts of the world, it's pretty much unrecognizable because we have a huge variety of fruits, vegetables, nuts, legumes, different formats of foods. We even have dairy in many parts of the world. So it is a, you know, it's a big company, but there are parts of the world where we still face challenges in terms of entering the markets and really understanding the opportunities there. And one continent really that hasn't, you know, that hasn't, that we don't have a really strong presence in terms of our foods is Africa. And we face a number of issues in terms of development there. And among those issues really where we see a confluence between business opportunities and development opportunities are really three areas. One is agriculture, and particularly sustainable agriculture that addresses issues such as climate change and population growth and other stresses. Another is nutrition, particularly of our consumers, and ultimately also of our workforce and our producers in those countries. And the third area is in terms of talent creation and skills development, human resources development in these countries. And I don't want to dominate the conversation here, but perhaps I can share with you examples as we continue this conversation, which address all those points.
Thank you very much, Tara. Marco, tell us a little bit about Diageo. I also think, similar to Tara, you may want to explain, what is Diageo first? So,
very happy to do that. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here today. Thank you very much. I think from a short introduction's perspective, Diageo, as I say, is not necessarily the most well-known company. Luckily, most of the people in this room probably know some of our products. We are a premium drinks business. We like to say that we are the number one premium drinks business, actually. And we produce mainly spirits, but also beer and some wine as well. Some of our brands are famous brands like Johnny Walker, like Smirnoff, like Guinness, Gordon's, Bailey's, and some more local brands in some of the emerging markets where we are active. It's exciting to be here today to talk about development because I think from our perspective, it's something we have been embracing and trying to embedding into the core of our business for the last couple of years, but probably actually far more than a couple of years. Some of our brands are more than 400 years old, and some of the traditions we have across our business in the area of corporate philanthropy and corporate social responsibility are not exactly 400 years old, but almost 200 years. Typically, a good example we always make is our great Arthur Guinness back in the 18th century was actually a big corporate philanthropy person in Dublin and in Ireland and actually beyond Ireland. So it's a tradition that we've had in our company for a long time. Now, as many other companies in the current sort of environment, we go through a bit of a transition where we have engaged into that kind of journey where we have been talking about corporate philanthropy for many years. We went then into the whole corporate social responsibility conversation and are quite desperately trying to stay away a bit from that these days because we believe that even if perhaps calling it sustainability might not be the right word, we believe that not focusing too much on the social responsibility aspect but trying to focus efforts in those areas into the core of our business will actually support our business but also development. We have, just to summarize briefly, we have a strategy which is based on three pillars. One is around what we call alcohol in society, coming from the nature of our products. We are conscious that alcohol can have a negative impact on societies, and we see it as a responsibility to actually address that, to work with organizations, government organizations, non-government organizations, other companies to address that. That's one big focus area. A second big focus area is water and environment. The production of our products requires enormous water resources, sometimes in areas, typically in Africa. 1 liter of beer requires more than 140 liters of water to be produced. So it makes lots of sense for us to engage into that area. And a third pillar is around local socioeconomic development, which we believe is probably the newest to our strategy. and probably also the one where we have less guidelines and clarity on how to progress and move forward. But we also believe the most exciting of those pillars, because that's where we can make a real difference in terms of development, local development, and hence also support our business. And I'll be happy, a bit like you, Tara, to talk about some examples throughout this panel conversation.
Papa, you provide an African perspective to this conversation. What the report talks about is that many African companies do this as if it's something that's second nature to them. Talk a little bit about your perspective on this.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. I think for before I get into that, it's important to sort of, without kind of doing propaganda, tell a little bit about what we do, because I think it gives you a little bit of perspective on some of the comments that I will be making throughout the afternoon. We are a private equity fund management company, and we basically invest in African indigenous companies as our primary target across West and Central Africa, and that is from Morocco all the way south to Angola inclusive. And what we do is growth and expansion. And we basically look at companies that already exist, and we try to help them get to the next level. So we want to believe that the money we provide these companies is the least useful part of what we do, as much as it's critical for them. We give a lot of advice, we avail our networks, we give them best practice, and we basically work shoulder to shoulder with them on their growth, which basically means that we can't have a portfolio of 200 companies. It's usually a pretty limited club that we work with. We are not sector specific. We work across the sectors, and I think when we talk about strategy, that would be socially or developmentally conscious, I'll say, you know, we think everything that we do ends up being in that position. And that brings me back to what you said, that development is second nature. I wouldn't even go to make it, put it that far down the path, the totem pole. I think development is completely interwoven with what we do day to day. If most of your customers are below the poverty line, if you're providing them a service, are you providing them a service or are you actually doing development? If most of the banks you invest in are actually, you know, dealing with the population that is extremely poor, and that they're trying to, you know, make some money while give them a service, is that social consciousness or is it just business? So for us, it's just business. And we believe that it's important in this conversation to separate between looking at this conversation from a US or developed country perspective and adapting it to Africa, rather than where I'm coming from, which is we're in Africa and we listen to what's going on other places as best practice and as comparables, but we really have to develop our own approach and our own way of doing things. It may look like everybody else's way of doing things, but it is our own because we need to adapt it to the local reality. And all of that is to say, in summary, that development for us is not an option, a strategic alternative. It is a strategic imperative. And we don't get up in the morning and say, okay, what is our development work today? We just say, what is our work today? And then people, when we discuss with visitors, they ask us, how are you doing on social impact? We're like, okay, what are the metrics you're using? And then we respond to that. And usually 99% of the time, we're smack in the middle of whatever development, metrics there are being used. So I think throughout the afternoon, I'd like to provide a complimentary viewpoint on this conversation, but take it from that perspective.
Thank you very much. Okay, Agnes, we've had as we've gone down the panel, you've seen sort of a shift from multinational companies who are thinking about development and sort of an evolution in their thinking about development. Heard from a finance company. Talk a little bit about, hey, AID is looking at this, and you bring a unique perspective to this, having been at IFC and the Grassroots Business Fund, and now coming to AID with a private sector development and development finance perspective to your job at AID.
Good
Great, thank you very much. And first, I would really like to thank CSIS and IGD for this amazing opportunity to really sit at the table with such an amazing panel of business people. It's not often that we get to kind of mix in this company, so thank you very much. Last week, CSIS also hosted Deputy Assistant Administrator for Africa, Raja Jandalia, who did speak about trade and investment in Africa. So I do see that as a continuation of that conversation, so thanks for that as well. As all of you know, Africa has been experiencing very strong economic growth over the last decade. Six out of the top 10 fastest growing economies in the world are in Africa. Trade has increased over 200% during the last decade. However, all of that growth really has not translated into significant poverty reduction. So I think at this point, everyone agrees that increased investment is really required, not just of funds, but also of knowledge transfer in order to spur that economic growth. And it's definitely been recognized by President Obama, who is really putting spurring economic growth at top of the agenda for African development from the USG perspective. I do think that it's important to note that this builds already on a couple of presidential initiatives, including Feed the Future, Partnership for Growth, who some of you might be familiar with, who also have a very strong component of partnering with the private sector towards developmental goals. I want to tell you a little bit about the Private Capital Group for Africa, which is the group I represent, which USAID recently established, also to really strengthen our efforts in this field. So PCGA was established in consultation with our partners, including other development partners, but also African governments and U.S. government agencies. We're building on the efforts that I've mentioned earlier of really increasing private sector engagement along the developmental goals for USAID and the U.S. government in Africa. So what is it that we actually do, and what kind of value proposition do we offer? The value proposition is really that we are bringing the convening power, the risk mitigation tools, and the geographic presence and expertise of our staff in Africa to help private sector and other partners really partner and focus on how can we jointly align interests and achieve results that not only us, but also the countries are really looking forward to achieving to reduce poverty. And what do we actually do? So we're both supply-driven and demand-driven. On the demand side, what we do is we help the African missions, the USAID missions overseas, to interact with the private sector and try to jointly develop and implement initiatives which meet our joint interests. On the supply side, we offer a one-stop shop for investors who are interested in Africa and interested in exploring or entering the space with the help of or the assistance of USAID. I think maybe I should give you an example of something that we're doing now, which might make it a little bit more practical. We're currently working on a project, or I'm going to say an investment, in West Africa. As most of you know, SMEs in West Africa have a very difficult time obtaining long-term growth capital. So what we have done is we've partnered with Rabobank and a couple of multinationals to form a local non-bank lending institution, which will be providing long-term capital to SMEs working in agribusiness in several countries in West Africa. This is actually a partnership of not only the private sector, but also several USAID missions working together, because normally we find it much easier to work on a bilateral basis, but they're actually working on a regional basis to support something that is scalable on the regional basis and maybe on a continent basis if things go well. So Rabobank and the multinationals are bringing in their knowledge and capital, And USAID is also contributing our resources, convening power, and capital with the hopes of providing $135 million in SME loans over the next 5 years in the region. I think the other reason this is really important is because that kind of partnership, in addition to forming this new company, is really helping us establish a platform of maybe continuing the dialogue with the multinationals and with the banks on how else can we further economic development and agribusiness in that region. So for example, we're discussing how can we seed an agribusiness academy to teach agronomists some basic business principles. So out of that partnership, not only is that one corporation being formed, but also a dialogue that could have a huge impact on the continent. So I'll just end with that example. I hope it was clear enough. And I just wanted to say that this is a new development paradigm, and the success of that paradigm really depends on how well can we engage with the private sector towards developing economic growth.
Well, I've got questions for each of you, and I'll start with you, Tara. If you tell us a little bit, you left me hanging and wanting to know more about your work in with Pepsi in that sort of illustrates some of the I was hoping for some examples of how Pepsi is doing this, but I'd also like you to just also think about how you're interacting with the U.S. government, if at all,
right. And
if you could talk about that as well.
So you know, it's great that Agnes just shared these comments, because in fact we're working with USAID very closely on one of the issues that I had mentioned. So I had mentioned agricultural development, nutrition, and talent development. And particularly on the side of nutrition, USAID, World Food Program, PepsiCo, and now the Ethiopian government also have joined together to help to develop in Ethiopia an alternative ready-to-use supplementary food product that can help to feed hungry Ethiopian children. This has been quite a groundbreaking project in many different ways. Firstly, it's our first real entry into Africa, together with the help of USAID, really, which facilitated all of these interactions and this partnership, so we really value that relationship. We actually have a quite broadly worded global memorandum of understanding with USAID and with the World Food Program to help develop nutritious products and introduce agricultural improvements in several countries across sub-Saharan Africa, as well as in other parts of the world. So the work that we're doing in Ethiopia is really to help develop an alternative to Plumpy Nut, which maybe some of you have heard of.
I was going to say it's the Pepsi Plumpy Nut,
right? The Pepsi Plumpy Nut, if you like. Whereas actually it's actually supported by PepsiCo Foundation, and the World Food Program is really developing the product, and it's very much branded the World Food Program. But we are, you know, very much partners in that process. We are helping to, it's really World Food Program that is leading that effort, and they have, in fact, got to the point where they've developed the product. They have a prototype, and it's being reviewed by the Ministry of Health in Ethiopia. And we very much hope that the product is going to be launched later this year. But the really significant part about this project is that it offers an affordable alternative, an affordable nutritious alternative to Plumpy Nut, it's a chickpea-based product, so it offers protein to the same extent as Plumpy Nut, and we are hoping that this will be a viable alternative for agencies such as the World Food Program.
Tara, let me just stay with you just for one more minute. When I think about Pepsi, and I think about having to balance long-term development objectives, long-term business objectives, and let's say and shorter-term objectives of shareholders, how does Pepsi balance that? I suspect that may be on the minds of many people in the audience.
Yeah, so the answer is with great difficulty. But I think this is a challenge that faces every major company. And I think the answer really is to find these alternative ways of functioning, so that even if it's not the business that is producing this product, we can find another way to support the development of this product so that ultimately people in these communities where we are interested and we have an interest to ultimately develop a business in the long term, we can show that we have, you know, created opportunities, we can show that we have created a well-intentioned effort that is associated with the company. So ultimately, consumers are going to say, well, okay, PepsiCo may not have come in and put in a factory and started producing products here today, but 5 years down the road, consumers in these countries are possibly going to recognize us for the good efforts that we have been behind and enable us to then establish our businesses in a more conventional way.
Okay, Marco, I understand you have a series of initiatives in Ethiopia as well. This seems to be Ethiopia Day here at CSIS, but if you could, you have significant footprint in Africa, more than I think most people in this audience realize in terms of both selling products in Africa and sourcing products in Africa. You have a new initiative working with smallholder farmers, sourcing soy and barley. Talk a little bit about that initiative and also talk a little bit about how you integrate the business case for development into your business model more broadly.
Yeah, very happy to do that. Thank you. I mean, you mentioned the African perspective. It's true. It's something that is usually quite a surprise to people. One out of four people working for Diageo work actually in Africa. We sell our products in more than 40 countries across Africa. And the turnover of our African business unit today is roughly £1.3 billion, which is approximately 15% of our overall turnover, and is expected to be doubling in the next 3 to 4 years. So expectations are massive, and the growth opportunities are incredibly important. It's also a business which is slightly different than the overall Diageo business, without going too much into details, but overall Diageo makes about 80% of its business, or our turnover, comes out from spirits. Whereas in Africa, more than 80% comes from the beer side of the business. And who says beer says also bigger sort of footprint in terms of production. And we have 17 breweries today across Africa. And a bit to the point you were making, Pap, I think the whole development area, the development aspect of our business in Africa is part of daily business, because you can't do business otherwise in Africa. The example of Ethiopia, I think it's showing, I think, quite well what we have been doing in the past. We're trying to do more and more, embedded even more into the business. We have recently taken over a brewery in Ethiopia, which is the Meta Abo Brewery, in January this year. And today, in Ethiopia, roughly 50% of the barley that is required to produce beer is actually imported from abroad. And it's very similar, even more so actually, than 50% for the Meta Abo Brewery. Now, without being an expert on Ethiopian agriculture, it's quite easy to see that there's a potential to actually source much more of that input locally. And that's exactly what we're trying to do. We have actually, as a couple of months ago, started a project working together with the ATA, the Agricultural Transformation Agency from Ethiopia, from the Ethiopian government, on a barley sourcing project where we've reached out to 1,000 smallholder farmers with the objective of sourcing 1,000 metric tons of barley for the production of our beer in Ethiopia. This covers roughly 5% of the overall input need that we would have for our beer, but the objective is to get to a point, this is a pilot project, that if we see that things work out in the right way, within 5 years we would actually potentially source all of the required input, all of the barley, locally. I think to the question about how do we embed this into the business, I think we tried almost to sort of look at it in a different way. What kind of value can this deliver to the business? Because I mentioned the word sustainability before. It's a bit of a hype word. Everyone talks about sustainability. But I think, to me, the only way to actually support sustainability is to sustainably embed the sustainability into the business. So lots of sustainability here. And we are a business which is basically here to deliver shareholder value, possibly on the long term, but quite often on the short term. So we face business constraints. And typically in Africa, with the local requirements in terms of inputs, the local sourcing, the sourcing from those goods is actually crucial. We import roughly 50% of our crops from that we need for our production in Africa from out of Africa. Now again, this is a bit like Ethiopia. One can think that it's quite easy probably to find ways to source that locally, but 50%, so we have ships from Belgium sort of coming down into Tanzania and getting their crops over into the brewery and producing beer, which doesn't make much sense. So one way is to support the local sourcing. It reduces cost. It takes significant risks away from the foreign exchange fluctuation, which is a major one. And it also supports basically local wealth creation, which at the end of the day supports the business. So there's some very tangible reasons why we should support that. Now, this sounds all very easy and straightforward. It isn't that easy, unfortunately, that straightforward, but that's what's guiding it, and that's what's embedding our efforts in this area into our business.
Could you also talk a little bit about how you work with donor agencies? You're a UK-based company. Do you work with DFID, and if so, how? Do you work with the Swiss Aid Agency? Do you work with the Germans? Or talk a little bit about, given that you have such a large African footprint, are you engaging with, it could be the U.S. government, but I suspect it may more likely be working with European donors, if at all.
Yeah, it's true. I think our background is more, even if we are actually listed on the New York Stock Exchange, it's more sort of the European area. But I think it's fair to say that we are probably not that experienced in working with the government agencies. We have some ad hoc projects. We've worked with the GIZ, the German agency in Cameroon, on a project. We are engaging with DFID on projects, but it's not, I think, as common and regular as we would wish it to be. Somewhere, I think it comes because some of the projects that we roll out, we just do them even if we don't get the kind of support from government organizations, because it makes business sense. I think that's even more powerful. But I think we could take the whole development support to a much bigger scale if we were able to successfully engage with government agencies. And we were we had that conversation over lunch, obviously. I think very open to engage into that. I think it's also fair to say that we've sometimes encountered sort of diverse feedback from those agencies.
Todd, why don't you share a little bit about what sort of feedback you've got?
I think it's, well, typically when you come as a drinks business, some of these organizations basically say we don't work with drinks business.
So it's a selective morality, right?
There is a bit of that. But I think luckily I'd say that this is changing. But I also would say that's a bit like, I guess, when you walk through business, and I think that case was made over lunch as well, I think you can really get some quite diverse feedback. Some people, and it comes sometimes down to quite individual, because it's the same organization, but depending on who you talk to, there seems to be openness, or there seems to be limited openness to engaging with the business. And there's also a sense from our side that conversations seem to be taken to a certain point, but then sometimes it's difficult to get over the next step, the threshold. And I think some fair questions are coming back from those government organizations. Why should, under the current circumstances where austerity, at least in Europe, but I'm sure it's probably similar in the US, is a key topic, why should governments actually put money into projects from big multinationals who make massive profits? And we had that conversation, how can actually governments take advantage from organizations making money out of that? I think it's the kind of return investment conversation. So quite a complex conversation, but overall, I think from my perspective, it's the conversations are opening up, and it's becoming much more sort of looking into potential ways of working together rather than which I have been seeing in the past. How can we possibly avoid to work together but stay polite, which is not very productive.
Agnes, I'm just going to warn you, I'm going to come back to his rhetorical question about this issue of how should we be working with the for-profit sector from a government perspective. So just, but I'm going to move to Papa. Just, could you talk a little bit about, Papa, if you could speak to how your fund engages with DFIs or donors more broadly? I'm thinking of IFC or OPIC, or do you work with AID's Development Credit Authority? Could you talk a little bit about that? Or if you don't, I'd be curious as to why not.
Well, the opportunities to work come from the two angles of what we do. We raise the money and we deploy the money. On raising the money, today, I would say the vast majority of our investors are DFI. So that has a number of consequences in terms of how we do our business and the things that we focus on. Thankfully, our interests are aligned, so we've not had to actually be imposed upon in terms of environmental rules and so on and so forth. These are things that we wanted to do because I think it's best to own these types of processes. That's from a fundraising standpoint, and I think their support is tremendous in launching this business into Africa, because a lot of potential investors internationally just get very scared, or the scale is not of interest enough to sort of get them less scared. Because I think if the scale was there, there are much riskier places where a lot of money is going today. So I think the DFI's role in the launching of this type of business is critical. And just to make a small technical point on this, right now Africa is probably the last place left in the world where people like myself actually invest in pure equity. Everywhere else, the equity that you put in is highly leveraged because the financial systems enable you to do that. And it's a very expensive way to do business because, you know, when you take KKR, if they're going to buy like a big railway or something, they'll put in 5% or 10%, and then the rest will be borrowed from banks. And then next thing you know, they've done a multi-billion dollar deal. If we do a multi-billion dollar deal, which we don't do, all of it will be equity. So as a result, this money is coming from the DFIs is a very critical piece to a continent that is in desperate need of people bringing in equity in an environment in Africa right now where most of the financing is from banks. So that's on that side. On the side of actually investing in on the day-to-day work, we find that the work with the DFIs is critical, but we find that it's facing major challenges in terms of transforming itself as time goes. I think right now, when I look at the work that Agnes is doing, for example, it's a very clear, obvious sign that USAID has woken up and said, look, this is the way we want to adapt to the new environment, as opposed to this is what we've been doing when we want to extrapolate for that for the future. So I think it's very critical to be creative, and I think the most creative DFIs right now will be the successful ones, and the more status quo-oriented ones, we'll be talking about them in the past and within the next 10 years or 15 years, because things are changing really quickly, certainly in the Africa environment. So it's very important that the creativity not be left to the guys like myself and others, but the DFI also jump in the game. So I think that coming up with new ways to adapt their previous products is going to be very, very important. For example, when we look at DFIs investing in a fund like ours, and they say we want to do co-investments because you guys can go out and find the deals and we'll come in. They really need to be serious about that, because indeed we do have better due diligence capability on the deals that we look at. We're on ground, we're talking to the companies and so on, and we know what the DFIs also are looking for. So it's not like we're using the DFI money to actually do corrupt things or to ruin the environment. Everything actually works quite in sync. So I think it's a way for them to leverage their work, but they need to be prepared to come in. And when they come in, then not say, well, we're a DFI, so we have to go through these 20 processes in order to get to point A, from A to B. Because by the time they're at stage 5, we're actually done and we've moved on. And then it's frustrating for them because they've wasted time and we feel. So I think adapting is really the main challenge that I put out to the DFIs, and those that can do that will do very, very well.
Okay, Agnes, what do you say when people say, well, this is a subsidy for companies that don't need it, this is corporate welfare? Talk a little bit about your perspective, and then maybe I'd actually ask the entire panel to comment on this issue of, well, is this, should donor agencies be working with companies? Is this corporate welfare? Is this a good idea? Because these are the criticisms that you'll hear. I mean, this is the pushback that you get from some. quietly, but it's still there. Would Agnes, please?
No, absolutely. I mean, that's, I think it's a discussion that is ongoing. I want to kind of give you three examples of how I see alignment of interest of development institutions and private business. And I could use, actually, Diageo, for example, as an example of why I think it's a good idea to work with them. One is on the development of local businesses. So all of these countries really need assistance, whether it be capital or knowledge, on development of local businesses. When a company like Diageo starts sourcing locally, they are contributing that knowledge and plugging all the small businesses into their international system. So one is the development of the local businesses that we will need to support the development. No matter how many corporations come and invest in Africa, there will still need to be local SMEs and small businesses to provide enough jobs for everyone. The second example is on the distribution. I mean, if you noticed, every little village that you go to in Africa either has Coca-Cola or they're certainly selling beer and so on. So,
or Pepsi.
Or Pepsi. Sorry. I mean, why could we not partner with these companies who are fabulous at establishing very efficient, locally owned distribution systems to distribute other things that are needed in rural Africa? So that's another very strong alignment of interest. And the third one is on talent development. Human capacity is still a huge issue on the continent. And I think that we cannot just rely on the local universities to keep producing managers and mid-managers and distributors that I know your businesses need, but also that other businesses on the continent need, including the local ones. So things like linking up on internships and doing internal management training is really another very strong component why I think working with any company is a win, really, for development agencies.
Let me hear from the rest of the panel on this question, because it came up in the lunch that we had, the pregame, for some of you who were there. But just what's your response when people in the development community would say, well, I'm not sure we want to do this. You all are well-equipped to handle these challenges yourself. Maybe Marco and Tara and then Papa, if you could each comment on that.
Yeah, very happy. I mean, I think the main challenge from a private sector, and I'm talking obviously from our position, is that, having mentioned before, shareholder value is sort of the overarching objective for a company like Diageo. And if you look at investments that we do, generally speaking, return of investment on investments of our investments are usually 18 months. That's quite far off already. But some of the structural investments we're looking into, if we talk about supporting local sourcing, we can talk about 5, even 10 years return on investment. And I think that's where we come to the limits of how much can we actually take on. And if, again, to support the sustainability of our projects, we need to embed this into the business, that's where, facing some of the hard-nosed businessmen, they will say, or businesswomen, and say, well, I'm not putting out that money. Because also what we try quite strongly to do so is really keep those decisions at local level, rather than having someone in London saying we're going to do this, is actually engage with the local management team in Addis and having them deciding and having them putting the money on the table. But those people need to deliver a bottom line at the end of the year. And if that's impacting their results, they might say, well, we're not doing it. So I think addressing and having conversations with the DFIDs and USAIDs of this world is something that we see, obviously, partially supporting enormously because of the credibility it adds to the project. And the expertise that comes in from those organizations, I think, is something that we sometimes are a bit cowboys in the perspective of business people coming in, but having some people who really know the local missions, know how it works, the country, I think some things we're seeking for. But also supporting, again, some financial support to support the scale and the long-term investment of it.
Just thinking, Papa and I were having an earlier discussion about DFIs. For those of you who aren't familiar with what DFIs are, development finance institutions, and so the U.S. government's version of that is OPIC, the Overseas Private Investment Corporation, and AID has an instrument, a related instrument called the Development Credit Authority, and in Britain the agency is called CDC, not the one in Atlanta, but the one in the UK. It's CDC, but the Commonwealth Development Corporation, and then Agnes and I both worked for the World Bank's version of it, which is the International Finance Corporation. So I think Marco's comment about sharing finance, there's a issue around sharing financial risk and helping to get those sorts of development outcomes often requires not just grant resources, but various sorts of financing resources as well, in investment type resources.
Yeah, and I guess just to finish off, I think the conversations we've had, or at least I've had with some people at DFID, is that it is quite new to them as well, engaging with private sector around those questions, and that there is willingness on actually creating frameworks that allow us, that allow actually us to look into those sort of long-term projects, but also allow an organization like DFID to actually declare a return on investment, which actually supports the government budget as well. But I think it's almost a bit like this is stage zero, and how can we take this further? Which we don't know, and we would love to engage with all those organizations and USAIDs and others, obviously, to understand how we can take this further, because I think getting that right will be an incredible support for development.
Could speak to this as well.
Sure. So, I mean, I think I would agree with a lot of the comments that have been shared right now, but I would also like to just flip it a little bit, because I've actually had a lot of receptivity from USAID, from OPIC, from other such institutions, and in fact, we've been working hard with them to come up with models and pilots that could demonstrate the appropriateness of this type of public-private approach. But in fact, I've heard the reverse coming from within the company, from some of our more, I would say, more conventional private sector-minded people, business people, who say, well, why do we need to engage with the US government? Or why do we need to engage with OPIC? Why don't we just do this ourselves? Isn't it simpler? And the answer is, yes, it probably is simpler, but in geographies like Africa, where we don't have that familiarity that you were talking about, we don't have the local knowledge, we're really at ground zero in terms of just starting to understand what the consumer needs are, what the local capacity is, what the capabilities are, how to even get raw materials to your factory. How to start producing, how to sell, how to market. This is where I think both local institutions as well as institutions the advisory capacity of the U.S. government, the USAID missions in countries are really helpful. And I think the one other issue I'd like to put on the table right now is that whenever we have approached these organizations with ideas, they're really looking for scale, and we are we're at such an early point that we're talking about, for us, 1,000 farmers would be huge, and I don't think that 1,000 farmers really cuts it for organizations like Bill and Melinda Gates, for example. So we're at that point, I think, where we want to start to put our foot in the waters, our toes in the waters, and test the ground. But we're looking for partners who can really help us achieve that, that first step, take that first step in these countries. And, one example is I've actually got really interesting pilot projects that have actually come from the business to us, to our function within PepsiCo. And, they're saying, how can we engage with such and such NGO in such and such country to procure these raw materials? But do it in a partnership so that we're not taking on all the risk ourselves. And those are the types of opportunities that I'm really seeking support for from development organizations.
Papa, please.
Some of the debate is actually, I don't mean this in disrespect, some of the debate is confusing to me, because to me, most of the guys that I work with that invest in private sector in Africa are making money hand over fist. So I'm not clear on this dichotomy between are you doing something bad or do you need to support this and that. To me, DFIs should be on the spectrum of risk appetite in the private sector. DFIs have a very strong role in the initial stage of the risk profile. So, if there's something never been done, DFIs can do that because the regular financial company will be thinking three times, maybe too much, and will not do it. And if the U.S. wants to be part of the competitive landscape that's shaping up worldwide, I think it's in the U.S. business interest to do that. I mean, the Chinese are not kind of having discussions about the developmental impact, is my guess. I mean,
that's probably a good guess.
Okay. All right. So I'll continue guessing then. And when the French president travels to Africa, he brings in like a ton of business people, and they're there to sign contracts. I mean, the biggest margins for Air France, they're on their flights to Africa. It's just to give you. So there was a time, I think, in the 70s, 80s, in the middle of the whole structural adjustment process, where Africa was like eighth heaven. But that time is moving, is changing very quickly. And I think the debate also in the U.S. needs to adjust to that change. And you look at an organization like OPIC is making money. And by investing in the private sector in the developing world. So to me, it's more defining the work of development finance institutions as just a seamless part of a risk appetite across the board. That if Pepsi is going to hesitate to go into Malawi on their own, maybe there's a role for USAID to be there with them in the initial stage. Because all of this is ultimately going to be bringing back profits to the U.S. and is going to be creating jobs in the U.S. ultimately. If Pepsi does well, the U.S. does well. And and the opposite obviously is obvious. So to me, that's a very important thing to sort of keep in mind. And I think, as scary as it may sound, there's something to learn about the way the Chinese are doing it. Not to emulate them or copy them, but there's something to learn. The Chinese will come in and they'll like take over a telecom company in DRC, let's say, which they've done, and compete with the local other companies. And separately, they'll build a stadium, but they don't mix the two. And I think the debate that we continue to have mixes the two. How do you have a cell phone company that builds a stadium? Because that cell phone company is going to fail, because the cost of the stadium is too high. So there should be some sections that build stadiums and sign things and have nice pictures in newspapers with governments. And then there should be some people who are out there making business and making money. But if you try to tell U.S. businesses, go out there and do the two under an umbrella of developmental impact, you're just increasing their costs. So that's the part that I think is also important to bear in mind.
Agnes, in the pre-lunch we had a discussion about how do we bring together the various instruments of the U.S. government to take better advantage of the opportunities that we're hearing being discussed here on this panel. Could you talk a little bit about what you're seeing as you look inside AID? Having been there maybe about a year now, or maybe a little less than a year. Talk a little bit about, okay, you know that aid has part of the set of instruments. MCC has some, the Trade Development Agency, the Ex-Im Bank, OPIC, and others. If you could just talk a little bit about that. And then also, could you talk a little bit about the mindset that you're finding within AID, and how would you compare that also to being inside IFC, having been there in the past, if you talk about that, because I think that should be revealing and interesting.
Thanks, Dan. So first, I just wanted to, I'll start with the middle question first, which is how do we really align all the resources that the U.S. government has at its disposal? There is no easy answer to that. It's a process. I think it begins with not only sharing information among the agencies, but also with the private sector. So developing a way of a systematic ongoing dialogue between the private sector and the U.S. agencies, either on a regional basis or on a country basis, to compare what are our plans and abilities in each country to what are the private sector plans and abilities in each country, and really connecting the dots. So I think that's a long-term process, and I think it's more of a plan than anything else. But if we can move towards that, I think a lot of things would happen. Comparing kind of what's happening at USAID and private sector engagement versus IFC, I think that's difficult to compare to some extent. I mean, IFC's main mission is really poverty reduction through investment. So investment is kind of embedded in the mission of the organization, as opposed to USAID, which is much more developmental in nature. However, I think there's a recognition, and this speaks a little bit to what Papa was also saying, that first of all, there is a role that U.S. government and specifically USAID can play, because if you look at, as I mentioned earlier in my remarks, when you look at all the FDI, all the foreign direct investment that's been going into Africa, and you compare that to rates of poverty reduction, it's really not, the poverty reduction is not as strong as you would expect it to be. So I think the role for development agencies and USAID is really to first help companies move their investment towards sectors that are key to poverty reduction, and second, to help them really develop ways of affecting that on the ground as they source, as they sell, to really, and I think that's what Tara was saying, to really help them recognize how they can be developmental in nature while still doing their business. I think that's a really strong role. And I think that recognition is very strong within USAID and within U.S. government right now, and I think that's going to lead to quite a bit of not only discussion, but real change on private sector engagement.
Okay, I think we should open it up. There are a lot of thoughtful people in the room, and you've all been very patient. So we've got, I believe, some microphones here. Let me see. I've got a gentleman here and a gentleman here. So we'll start, and we're going to bunch them together. So if you can keep your question brief, if you can identify yourself, please.
My name is Zeke Kennedy de Kumba. I'm actually an independent. Addressing a twofold question. One to Mr. Ndiaye, and the second fold to Ms. Bayswell. I do understand that every business goes in, I said, we go in business with expectation of maximizing a positive impact on your return on your investment. And then in a post-Cold War era, and how can you leverage equal development opportunity in conflict zone where there is no rule of law? And the second fold is Ms. Daisley. What is your approach in promoting positive local government or to strengthen the constitution that takes up an ability or control and the case also that is
does the microphone work? Can you test it, please?
Hello.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. My name is Benga Agunjimi, and my question is to the panel and particularly to Papa. You mentioned that the businesses you support, that the financial capital is list of the resources you connect them with. And my question is, how can the diaspora professionals of African descent collaborate with you in strengthening these emerging businesses to become stronger institutions?
Okay, very good. So why don't we take those questions. Who wants to go first? Why don't you go first and take the diaspora question first, if you would, please.
Well, the diaspora collaboration is central to what we do, actually, because I'd say, just to do some quick math, 80% of our staff is really diaspora. If you're calling diaspora guys who are abroad going back to Africa or guys who are abroad working with Africa, so that's the first level of collaboration. The other thing, the other area of collaboration is also in terms of just technological transfer. We use a lot of consultants. We use a lot of specialists in different areas. And it's always more helpful if those people have actually a local affinity, because there's always some adaptations to be done, and there's a lot less that is lost in translation when you have somebody who comes in. For example, we just used a Nigerian consultant in Mauritania. He doesn't speak French, but he certainly could understand the power cuts. And how to deal with that and how to adapt to a number of things and actually produce a report on time instead of being frozen. So, you know, I say that kind of, you know, with tongue in cheek, but on a more serious level, it's more understanding the way people work with each other locally, some of the cultural affinities that come around that, where the reports end up being of high quality. So I think diaspora collaboration is something that we welcome and we certainly try to encourage. But really, those examples I give really can be dragged across the board in terms of everything that we do, because our work is really human resource intensive. So to the extent that we can get people from different backgrounds to come in and pitch in, that's very helpful. I don't know if that answers your question.
Agnes, I think.
Sure. On the positive local governance, so I think that, and I said this during a lunch, I think it's very important for businesses to, when they invest in developing countries, to really bring in the rigor of corporate governance, of transparency, to their local operations, because I do think that first, that serves as a model for other businesses as to how to be a successful business, but yet be transparent and very responsible to your shareholders and all stakeholders. But also it helps push some much needed regulatory reforms through, because when a business comes to the government and tells them, we really need you to amend this law because, in general, investors cannot invest or take or profit from what they're doing in your country, that really does resonate with the government on a much different level than when the U.S. government comes and says, you should do this regulation because that's what we do and that's better governance. So I think that the businesses have investment has a very strong role to play in encouraging corporate governance, transparency, and better regulations in countries. The second question was specifically about DRC. What we're doing there right now is under the Credit Development Authority, which is the guarantee program that Dan had mentioned, we are implementing a partial guarantee to a local bank to lend to agribusiness-focused SMEs in DRC, coupled with technical assistance that's being provided to the bank loan officers on how to work more effectively with agribusinesses. So that's one of the first things that we're doing. But once again, economic growth, especially in agribusiness, is a very important goal, including in the DRC.
Could you just bring Marco and Tara into this conversation about rule of law and institutions and enabling environment. Could you both talk about, you obviously are investing in working in some very complicated environments. Could you each just talk about your experience with working in complex environments and how you try to improve either the rule of law or what are some of the things that you look for to that make it attractive for you to want to do business in a country, either property rights or clear rules of the game? You could talk a little bit about it from both your perspective.
You know, one of the examples that I can think about is actually our work in India, where we, you know, we've engaged with research institutions and with the government over several couple of decades now, we do a lot of work with smallholder farmers. Mm-hmm. So issues such as land rights, issues such as water rights are very much part of our business. We find ourselves embroiled in those issues because we want to ensure that our supply chain is not interrupted. So we've, you know, we've been working with governments, with local governments, with local institutions, with the farmers themselves, with farmer cooperatives, to ensure that that, you know, those types of local governance issues are brought to the forefront immediately, and that we, you know, we work together with all these stakeholders to deal with these issues and make sure that they actually meet the standards that we require. It's actually a business imperative, so it needs to be done aside from the moral imperative. Maybe you'd like to add something?
Yeah, we're happy to do so. Thank you. I think it's a bit like your example, Tara. I think around various aspects linked to the production, obviously that requires some engagement with local governments. I think from our side, being a company that produces and distributes alcohol, the whole question around alcohol legislation, taxation, distribution rights, is something that triggers lots of conversation with governments. I think we have the advantage in most of our African business that we have a quite important footprint in terms of the size of the companies that allow us to quite easily engage in the dialogue with local governments. Now, those dialogues rarely are easy, but at least there is an exchange which we nurture.
Okay, other questions from the audience? Let's see. Okay, the woman back there and the woman back there. We'll bunch them together. This, you first, please.
Hi, I'm Tamara Arsenault with CHF International, and my question is for Agnes, a little drilling down a little deeper on the intergovernmental cooperation on the U.S. government side, because from an implementer on the ground, it can be very challenging to figure out, is it the economic attaché at the embassy? Is it the American Chamber of Commerce? Is it the Foreign Commercial Service representative? Is it the AID person? And of course, sometimes one agency, if they're funding you, doesn't really want you talking to the other parts of the U.S. government independently without them. So I'm just, you know, as you're trying to unfold this new effort, I'm just curious to hear a little more the details on some of the mechanics of how, on the ground, on the country team aspect, you're trying to work out the wrinkles of implementation.
Valdez, I'm with Relief International, and my question is more for Papa and Agnes. When you talk about investing in these sorts of businesses, or Agnes, when you mentioned investing in the banks so that you could move on to investment in small and medium enterprises, there's this sort of key thing where impact investors have said there's plenty of money, but there's not enough of a pipeline. For organizations working to try to prepare banks or other sort of businesses for investment, really what should we be doing to make sure that investment can happen? Because again, we've heard that funding is there, but there's really not much of a pipeline.
Agnes, why don't you start with this issue of impact investing? I think you've been around it for 5 or 7 years at this point now, so I suspect you have a view on this.
I think on the pipeline development, more and more people are really starting to recognize that this is an issue, that there are just not enough businesses out there who are ready to take on capital and deploy it towards growth responsibly. So I think a lot of efforts, not just by USAID, by us, but also by others, are now focused on how do we create earlier stage funds, companies that would be investing in riskier businesses on a long-term basis with a lot of technical assistance attached to it in order to create a pipeline for the banks and for the more traditional SME funds. So how do we create that escalator from angel financing, such as we have here in the U.S., from angel financing to small business financing all the way through to much more commercial type of financing? I think there are a lot of efforts around that. I don't think anyone has the perfect mousetrap, but I think there is a recognition that that's needed. So that's what I would say on the pipeline development.
Papa, could you comment on this issue of impact investing?
Just to give you a couple of statistics on pipeline development that may help kind of get the perspective. Every week, we get about 4 unsolicited requests for investment you can multiply that by, you know, open business days per year, and it gives you a sense every year how much volume there is of potential deals. Now, this being said, not every deal that comes in is the deal that you want to do. That is why we structured a specific vehicle that can be local, work with local investors, and so on. That means that all of a sudden we were able to, address a need that heretofore had not been addressed. So a number of the guys we've invested in so far would not have received investment if we did not create the vehicle that we have created. So I think when you look at it from that perspective, then you can say that the DFIs that have funded us should make sure that the next fund and the next fund that they fund will actually go towards meeting the objectives of investing in those underlying projects or companies that they are interested in. And I think that that's where the huge developmental impact comes in from the DFI's standpoint, directing fund managers. Because fund managers will do whatever they need to do. And if they don't, then they're just out of business. So, you know, in this case, right now, the fashion is what we're doing, is growth and expansion. But it's up to the investors, and the DFIs, as I said, are a very important part of investing in funds in Africa, to just say, okay, this is good, we're going to continue to support it. Now we want to support guys who do what Agnes just talked about, who want to do earlier stage. And then, you know, some people will pretend they know how to, some will, you know, and it just goes on. Because 10 years ago, just having a fund in Africa was a feat. And I think as the business matures, investors can actually decide that this is where we want to target our capital, and you know who can come out and prove to us and convince us that they can do it. Because I personally believe, and what I see from personal experience day to day, is that you know, we always have deals competing with each other. So we end up being more selective than is actually healthy, if I can say that, from a competition standpoint. I mean, we can ask for terms that are, by international standards, borderline outrageous and really are good for our investors, but really, does that make us good investors in the long run once it gets more competitive? Probably not. And I think, you know, that's just to show you that how the pipeline is strong locally, but you actually need to have people who can really go out and pursue that. So the whole idea of adding value is really not a social mandate for us. It's because we need to add value to prepare and scrub and clean these companies so that they can do a good job for us.
I want to put you on the spot, and I want Agnes to answer this question of, okay, we've had several discussions today in various fora around a one-stop shop within the U.S. government to engage with the U.S. government. Could you talk a little bit? You certainly have had a positive experience with the idea. Could you talk about it? Did you knock on door number one and it was the right door? Did you have to go from place to place? How do you deal with sort of other agencies? Can you talk a little bit about, is there a little bit of a, does it feel like a wild goose chase, or is it you found the right person and they helped you navigate the system?
I can't say that we have really found the right person for every, you know, pilot that we want to run. So I think it all depends on the nature of the work that we want to undertake. So for example, with the World Food Program on this chickpea-based ready-to-use supplementary food, USAID was a great partner. But on this, you know, the potentially procuring raw materials from different countries in Africa, I think we are knocking on the doors of OPEC because we think that there's a possible synergy there. So we are actually looking for different opportunities as we come across these different projects. So it's really learning as we go along.
Actually, Marco, I know you're a little bit a relative newcomer to engaging with bilateral donors. You've had, as you said, you had some experience with the Germans, and what's your experience been with the U.S. to date? Or you may not feel comfortable commenting on that, but if you have, I'd be curious what it's been.
I think it's very recent. I mean, we were in touch with USAID around our project in Ethiopia, which is part of the Grow Africa platform from WEF. which have been pulled in USAID to prepare the pre-G8 meeting on nutrition. And the experience has been extremely positive. I mean, from what I mentioned before, why would we sort of reach out to USAID? I think the kind of knowledge that comes in from people working in organizations like USAID is exactly what we need. And I think also engaging with the local missions, again, around knowledge, around understanding of the environment, incredibly relevant and valuable, and supporting exactly why we actually want to work with those organizations.
Okay, so Agnes, coming back to you on this issue of who do you talk to? Kind of the woman from CHF sort of put her finger on this, and that's why I wanted to ask Tara and Marco, because I think it raises sort of this broad issue. So how do you answer that question?
So I think that, first of all, I need to preface all of this by saying it's a process. But what we're trying to do is we really are trying to tackle the system from inside, this issue from inside out. Meaning that what we're working on is building the capacity of the missions who are on the ground and who are really in touch with what is happening in their countries to think about, this is a development problem that I have. Does the private sector play a role in this? If they do, what kind of tools do I have available from the US government to help address those risks that the private sector perceives and is not moving towards investment in that kind of sector? Instead of thinking, how do I help OPEC do more loans, or how do I do more guarantees? Which is a little bit of the thinking now. So we're really trying to flip the whole thinking process to be much more of a, how do I find a solution to an issue and engage the private sector on that, and what kind of tools do I have at my disposal? And I think going back to what I said earlier, the two things that will be needed for that are, one, a systematic way of exchanging information with the private sector, and also a very good knowledge of what are all the different tools that the US government has at its disposal to really help bring those solutions about. So that's why I'm saying it is a process, but it's definitely, there's a recognition that that needs to be worked on, and hopefully that will be one of the answers.
Okay, other comments or questions? My friend Thelma in the front row, the woman at front, and then this gentleman over here. Yeah, Thelma first.
I just wanted to make a comment that I hope has a question within it. But it's basically to get a handle on what our expectations are in this dialogue, because it seems like we have two evolutions here that basically were stimulated a bit independently, and it's not just been a factor of the reduction of the amount of money that we have based on the financial crisis and other matters, because it really began before that. And that's the evolution in the business community about how to use their interface in developing countries a bit more effectively, and to apply the business disciplines that they always apply to the problems they face in the markets that they have to invest in. Moving a bit away from let's build a school, let's build a hospital, et cetera, to how do we build human resources, how do we solve the problem. And as you said, Marco, often you're going to do the project anyway. You're the projects that you develop, you're developing for your own internal reasons, and whether governments help you is not quite integral to your thinking as yet. You're probably going to do those projects anyway. With respect to the evolution of, and so the government can legitimately say, why do we need to play a role if you're going to do those projects anyway? The evolution in the government is important too, because it's moved also away from kind of every year just distributing funds to contractors and then doing it the next year and the next year and the next year. Various development agencies have tried to interject business discipline into their thinking, as Agnes has described. How do we more effectively achieve development out of our processes? And so I think our question is, where do those circles integrate? And I think Tara and Marco and Agnes and Papa have all identified, specific ones, and I'm not sure there is a one model. As Agnes is saying, you kind of continue this process, recognizing that these evolutions are very positive, and we should continue to generate that evolution and find where government can play the most effective role for a positive result, as opposed to continuing just to dole out money. Papa identified, you know, risk management. We're on that continuum of risk management. And Tara has identified a couple of areas where government can actually help with information and et cetera. So I don't know what my question is, other than to help find where those intersects are without over defining them, so that you put yourself in additional boxes.
Okay. And the gentleman back there.
Hi, Lawrence Wild from Vega, and I might be asking the question that you were trying to ask. I see one of the issues private sector working with USAID is that private sector might have a great idea, let's, you know, in Ethiopia or another country, and if it doesn't align with the mission strategy for that year, for the next few years, there's really very little that the mission can do if they've got their money already allocated into health education, for example, or in a specific value chains, and chickpeas are not within those value chains. Now there's the GDA, there's the Development Innovation Ventures, which is a little bit more flexible. But my question to Agnes is, at USAID, what could USAID do differently so they're more flexible when these ideas come up? They could go more the rhythm that the private sector goes in. And on the other hand, what can you do to align yourself more with the rhythm of USAID?
Okay. Agnes, why don't you take this question first? Yeah.
Well, the first thing that I wanted to say is that I've heard this argument quite a bit about the misalignment of the timeline between the private sector and USAID, and it's definitely there. However, I mean, I do believe that it's also a function of the fact, I mean, the private sector doesn't decide in 6 months that they're going to go in Ethiopia, right? I mean, they've thought about it for quite a while. They've really done a lot of research. There's a fair amount of planning that's going on. So it might be an issue of when the interaction between USAID and the private sector starts to happen. So when they're already ready to go and they have decided their strategy. If we can kind of move that back and think about co-planning in an earlier time frame, then I think that would help. The second thing is, like I said, it's more about connecting the dots. So yes, the missions are very specific about what they want to do in each country. However, a lot of private sector plans happen to align with those. I mean, Diageo's and Pepsi's here do. Chickpeas is Feed the Future, a supply chain. So one of the things that we need to do is, once again, exchange enough information so that we see where are those easy wins, where is that alignment, and so that we can affect some GDAs and other projects and other investments around it.
Other comments from the panel? I want to put my friend Rob Schneider on the spot if we've got the microphone, because Rob, you've been at AID working on partnerships now for 5 years, almost 5 years. Why don't, maybe you could just make a comment based on sort of what you've heard about this issue of alignment and making this work. Could you just give it just a minute on that? Just, I know you'll thank me for that later, but please go ahead.
Sure. Hi, my name is Rob Schneider. I'm with the Global Partnerships Division within USAID, formerly GDA under Dan. And I would agree, Agnes, for a newcomer to AID, well done. Moving the timeline back is actually both from the private sector perspective as well as from the AID perspective. So I think that's one of the things we are in the process of teaching our own staff, as much as a number of you probably, it hasn't been said so explicitly, but the business of development and the business of business and the language there is very different. And so part of our job, and Agnes and other colleagues in the Global Health Bureau and Bureau for Food Security and other folks that work on partnerships within AID, is helping to train our colleagues in the missions where these activities really happen. and how to talk to business and how to move up our time frame of engaging these businesses so that once we come up with our, you know, whether it's the CDCS or the country development cooperation strategies or whatever five-year strategy we come up with, you have that ongoing engagement with private sector organizations so that when the projects come, you can actually engage in a meaningful way and actually allocate money there.
Please.
I think just to build on that from the other side, I think it sounds probably a bit simple, but I think it's just engaging and increasing more with that sector. I think, Tara, you mentioned that sometimes you face challenges internally about why do we actually need them. I think it's exactly the same for us. I think what we face is a challenge about education in terms of many people in our organization actually not really knowing what do USAID and DFID and those organizations actually do. They see them as basically banks that just throw money out. And so why do they not give us the money? Why do we need to answer that many questions to actually have a partnership? So I think working on our side in terms of education, making sort of clear to people what the benefits are, and then just simply talking and engaging, communicating more, definitely.
Great. Other comments from the panel, either Papa or Tara?
I would just agree completely with Marco and Agnes said. It's really about setting up those opportunities for dialogue and communication, and education. There's really no substitute for that.
Any comment? Okay. I'm just looking at the author of the paper, Jerry, and I want to give you a chance. I actually think, I'm just thinking about the fact that there's some very thoughtful people that I know they're going to want to connect with the people on this panel. And so maybe what I might do is just, we might end the panel now, and I'd ask Jerry to give some last comments and just what you've heard today and just comment on what you've heard. So if we could bring the microphone up to my friend Jerry, who's the principal author of the paper that we've been discussing. So here she is, Jerry.
I think the conversation has been incredibly rich, both at lunch and here at the panel. And the paper that we put out today laid out a number of recommendations that talked about this notion of getting at sustainable development outcomes by increasing the alignment between core business strategies and development initiatives. And we've had a number of examples of how the potential of that, you know, whether it's Diageo wanting to talk more with USAID and other donors, whether it's Pepsi and their positive experience with USAID, whether it's Agnes's valiant effort to combine, you know, feed the future value chains with the expansion plans of companies that we've been working with. So I think it's the beginning of a conversation. I think it's a terrifically impactful conversation, and I'm very grateful. I can't thank Dan enough for the opportunity for us to bring these various threads together today.
Well, CS is very grateful for partnering with IGD on this, and I want to thank our friends at Chevron for helping to sponsor the Chevron Forum, and please join me in thanking the panelists.